In chapter 5, we take a look at the standard 6349. So typically, it's not the most funny thing to look at the standard and read it, but it can give you some hints what is important when you manufacture or when you buy an electric machine. So this standard is valid for electric traction, so for rotating electrical machines for rail and road vehicles, and especially this part number 4, it is valid for permanent magnet synchronous machines. One of the first things you see is that it deals with converter fed machines. So in traction, the electric machine is always connected to a converter. So this is a power electronic device which controls voltage and current for the machine. In this case, the standard is valid for motors and for generators, so for all different types of electric traction machines. This standard is connected to another part, to 6349 part 2, and the part 2 deals with the induction machines, and part 4 deals with the permanent magnet machines. Although main parts are similar, there are some differences between the machines. What is the standard about? And what is the sense of the standard? In the end, you should be sure that the machine works as you want, so that the performance of the machine is to be confirmed, and is confirmed by tests. So you can be sure that it's suitable for this duty what you like to use it in. Usually when you speak about the machine, you talk about the power of the machine. But what is the power of the machine? Let's have a look here. There is something like a continuous rating. What is this? So the continuous rating is the mechanical output that the motor can deliver on the test bed for an unlimited time. So for example, if you have a motor with 120 kilowatt and you don't tell anything else about how to use it, then you assume that he can deliver this 120 kilowatts for unlimited time. And the standard already tells you that this is a value what is important of the, on the test bed, but it is not really important for reality, in a sense that it will deliver also in real life this power continuously. It means that it is some kind of equivalent rating what is a representative for the power what is needed from the motor. And how is this checked? When is the motor okay and when is it not okay? It's mostly about the temperature in the machine. So if the machine gets too hot, then it's definitely not okay. So the motor must stay within the specified temperature limits. Sometimes the continuous rating of the power may not be enough for you, and you may want to specify a short time rating. For example, you want to specify a power where you can use the machine, for example, for 1 hour, and the machine does not exceed the limits of the temperature rise during that time. And you do that by starting the machine in cold condition, run it for example 1 hour, and check then if the temperatures are still okay. One interesting thing is that the standard tells you explicitly that the machine and the converter designers shall collaborate. Why is this the case and why should it be in a standard? It's because in the railway industry, the motors and the inverters are very often produced and also designed by different people, and not only by different departments, but also often by different companies. And it's very important then that the machine really fits to the converter and the converter really fits to the machine. And to be sure that this works, it is written in the standard that they shall collaborate already at a very early stage, so that the machine can meet the requirements. Chapter 5.3 already gives us a hint about the typical temperatures for traction machines. So traction machines in railway business are usually highly utilized, and so also the temperatures are higher than in typical industrial applications. So also if you put some data into a data sheet, you should use special temperatures, reference temperatures. And for example, for the winding, you should use the reference temperature of 150 degree, and for the permanent magnets, 100 degree. So what about the tests? Basically, there are two types of tests. It's the type tests and the routing tests. If you want to get further information about your machine, then you still can do investigation tests as well. The type test is done with one machine of every new design, and it should prove the ratings, characteristics, and the performance of a new type of machine. And it's also important that a test specification should be sent to the customer before the tests start, and also the customer is typically provided with a full test report after the tests. Additionally, on every machine which is manufactured, also a routine test is done. And this routine test should demonstrate that the machine has been assembled correctly and it's able to withstand the dielectric tests so that the insulation is okay and that, for example, it runs smoothly. So it's not the full program of the type test, it's only reduced test, and it should just confirm that the machine is okay and can be delivered. And this should be done on all machines which are delivered. Investigation tests, finally, are optional tests, and they can be done to get more information about the machine. It is important that the result of these tests do not influence the acceptance of the machine. Finally, you can also do investigation tests to get more insight into the machine, but the results of these tests shall not influence the acceptance of the machine. The standard tells us which kind of tests should be done. So first, this is a temperature rise test with a converter. We'll speak about this on the next slide. And then to be sure that the electromagnetic performance of the machine is okay, you do a no load test and a current load test. This is also part of the routine tests. To be sure that the machine is mechanically okay, you do an overspeed test. To check the insulation, there's a dielectric test. And, of course, you must also check the machine for vibration, so to measure the vibration velocity, and also for noise. As you can see on this table, lots of tests have to be done. This is especially true for the type test. Typical type test can take from 1 to 2 weeks, and it's done on one machine of every new design. The routine test shall be performed with every machine which is manufactured, and therefore it's also important that the test doesn't take such a long time. The temperature rise test is one of the most important tests when you have finished a new type of machine. And with this test you run the machine for a certain time. It can be a specified time, like 1 hour, but most of the time it is a continuous heat run, so The machine is run until the thermal steady state operation is reached. And at the end of the test, you check the different temperatures within the machine. So one of the most important parts is the stator windings with its insulation. And for the insulation system, there are certain temperature classes, thermal classes. One class which is typically used for railway application is class 200. And class 200 means that the temperature rise above the temperature of the cooling medium can be 200 Kelvin maximum. So in case you have 40 degrees Celsius air inlet temperature, then temperature rise of 200 Kelvin is allowed, which means that within the machine winding, a temperature of 240 degrees Celsius is allowed. Sometimes you even use insulation systems with a higher thermal class, which a few manufacturers can offer, for example, class 220, and then you have allowed temperature rise of 220 Kelvin over the cooling medium. In our company, we recently even developed and tested an insulation system with class 250, which means that for an air inlet temperature of 40 degrees, an average winding temperature of 290 degrees Celsius, or for an encapsulated machine, even 300 degrees Celsius is allowed. And this is already pretty much more than for a typical industrial machine. There are also other parts in the machine where the temperature can be critical. For example, this is the permanent magnets for a permanent magnet machine, and also, for example, the bearings. But as there are so many different materials, and it also depends on the design of the machine, you cannot specify a certain value for the temperature rise. So the standard also only tells us that the temperature rise shall not be sufficient to endanger, for example, the permanent magnets or other parts of the machine. The standard also tells us which tolerances are allowed. So, for example, for the torque, it tells us that the torque should not be less than 95% of the specified value. Also, for the motor losses, they should not be more or should not exceed the specified losses by more than 1% of the rated output power. Also, the induced voltage shall not vary more than plus minus 10% from the specified value. And this is not always easy to achieve because, for example, you have tolerances within the magnets, so the magnetic flux of the magnet can be different from one magnet to another, then also the size of the magnet, the size of the steel sheet, and so on. To check if the machine is mechanically okay, an overspeed test is conducted, and this is always done at 1.2 times of the maximum working speed. And afterwards, the machine is usually disassembled and checked. The standard also provides us with numbers for the maximum velocity of vibration. During the routine tests, a no load test and a current load test is performed. So, for example, for a permanent magnet machine, that means that by measuring the voltage during no load testing, the magnetization of the magnet is checked, and the current load test gives us some information about the behavior of the machine under load. Also, with every machine manufactured, the electric test is performed. That means that the insulation of the machine is tested, and this is done at 2 times the highest peering voltage in the DC link plus 1000 volt. And this already puts high stress on the insulation, so this test only should be performed once. Every machine manufactured is also checked for vibrations, And in case of the routine test, this is not a certain value of the vibration is measured, but it's interesting to see that the standard says that it's necessary that the tester should decide whether the machine runs smoothly or not. And finally, the annex of the standard gives us limits for the noise. So especially for self-ventilated machines, this is very important because at higher speed they can become quite loud. And so depending on the speed of the machine, the maximum allowed power level, sound power level, is between 100 and 115 dBA. So summing up, we see that the standard 6349 gives us lots of information what you should look at when you specify, order, or test a new traction machine.